Now that you know how to work with multiplying rational numbers and rational expressions, let's just review what we know about base and exponents. So remember how a to power n, where n is a whole or counting number, refers to a times a times a, n times, where n is called the exponent and a is called the base. We also saw that if you have base to a power and another base to a power, then you can add the exponents. If you have a to a power to another power, you have a to the multiplication of the powers, and division was subtraction of the powers. We also worked with negative exponents. A to power negative n means 1 over a to the n. But if you have negative exponent in the denominator, then it goes to the numerator and becomes positive exponent. So this is a little bit of review. Base to a zero exponent gives you multiplicative identity or 1. So fractional exponents were radicals. So for example, a to the power 1 over n means nth root of a. Remember what we called a? The a that's sitting inside the radical sign is called what? Radicand, and n is called the index. All right, try these. So if I said, what do you think is 2 times 5 to the power 3? We saw that that's the same as saying 2 times 5 times 2 times 5 times 2 times 5, 3 times, right? But we also have multiplication, commutative property, and associative property. So what we can do is rearrange and multiply all the 2s first and multiply all the 5s together, giving us 2 to the power 3 times 5 to the power 3. So that tells you if you have 2 times 5 to the power 3, then we can really just take 2 to the exponent of 3 and 5 to the exponent of 3. You can always check. So that's going to be what? 8 times 125, which will give you 1,000. We could have gotten the 1,000 if you had just multiplied 2 times 5, which is going to be what? 10. And 10 to the third is 1,000. So that's another way of doing it. But what we're trying to go after is observation. Observing what? If you have 2 bases and the whole thing is raised to a power, then each base can be raised to that power. By using commutative and associative property of multiplication, we get that. So for all integer powers n and m, if you have a times b to the power n, then you can have a to power n and b to power n. All right, let's take a look at practice examples. So 2 to the fifth to the power 3 is the same as 2 fifths times 2 fifths times 2 fifths. Now that we know how to multiply fractions, what do? Multiply all the numerators, multiply all the denominators, which will give you 2 to the third or 5 to the third or 8 over 125. So in general then, if you have a over b, b non-zero to the power n, then that's going to be a to power n, b to power n. So we can take numerator of the base to an exponent of n divided by the denominator of the base to the exponent of n. How about negative 1 to the third power? That's going to give you negative 1 times negative 1 times negative 1, which will give you negative 1. So negative 1 to odd power is going to give you negative 1. Negative 1 to even power will give you positive 1. So if you have negative a can be written as negative 1 times a. So if you do negative a to the power n, then remember what we said. If you have multiplication, you can raise negative 1 to power n and a to power n. So when n is odd, we're going to get negative a to power n. And when n is even, we'll get positive a to power n, because negative 1 to even power is 1. Negative 1 to odd power is negative 1. All right, let's look at some properties of radicals. If you take nth root of a negative number, then you can pull the negative outside the root. And the reason for that is because negative numbers raised to odd power are negative, and that's why the same thing will happen if you take odd root, like 1/3, 1/5, and so on. So for all real numbers a and odd numbers n, nth root of a to power n, is going to end up with a to power 1 because nth root, remember, is the same as 1 over n power. And what do you do with the exponents here? You multiply them. So n times 1 over n will give you a to the power 1. If it's even number, you still get an a, but then you need to have a non-negative real number in here. For example, negative 2 squared is 4, and square root of 4 is 2, and not negative 2. On the other hand, if you're working with square root of negative numbers, negative square root 1 is I, so negative square root a is nothing but square root a times I. All right, let's take a look and see if you can simplify these. You have base, this is your base, to an exponent. And what we said is that you can take each of these and raise that to that power. That's what one of the rules we observed. So let's go ahead and do that. So each one of them will raise to the power negative 2, b to the third raised to the negative 2. And what do you do with exponents? You multiply them. So you'll end up with a to the 4, b to the negative 6. We can't leave any negative exponents. And so negative exponent, to make it positive, will have to go in the denominator. So you're going to get a to the 4 over b to the 6. All right, here, same thing. You have whole thing raised to the second power, so each term is going to be squared. Each term here is going to be cubed. And then multiply the exponents. So this is 2 squared, which will be 4. A squared squared, 2 times 2 is 4. Negative 3 times 2 is negative 6. C squared, 4 times 3 is so b to the 12. Negative 2 times 3 is c to the negative 6. All negative exponents we need to simplify. So first, let's just collect like terms. So a to the 4, there's no other a. B to the negative 6 and b to the 12 will give you b to the 6. C squared and c to the negative 6 will give you c to the negative 4 because you're adding the exponents. And since we cannot leave negative exponents, c to the negative 4 will have to go sit in the denominator and be positive exponent. All right, try this next one on your own. Pause the video here and see if you get them right. Remember, even if you are feeling like, I don't know how to do this, give it a try. Just anything that comes to your head, put it down. What's the worst thing that will happen to you? That it's wrong. And if it's wrong, you're by yourself and you can just erase it or scratch it and start over. Mathematicians, when they solve new problems, have many, many attempts and hundreds of attempts sometimes, and eventually you might get a solution. So to have that patience is something to cultivate. So do spend time working on it. So we have division, quotient raised to a power. Each numerator, denominator gets the exponent. Multiply the exponents. You have a to the 4 over b to the negative 6. And the negative exponent cannot be left, so you have to change it. It's in the denominator, so it's going to have to go sit in the numerator and make it positive exponent. Remember, if you're stuck, just rewind, go back, see how every problem was done so that you have a good sense of how to work with exponents. This is also a good review for something you did a while ago. All right, let's take a look at this. Again, you have numerator, denominator to the power, numerator, denominator to the power. So let's raise everything to the second power. So it will be x to the negative second to the second, 6 squared, y to the negative third to the second. This is a negative sign, and it's cubed, so that will remain negative, because negative 1 times negative 1 times negative 1 is negative. And then 2 to the third, x squared cubed, y to the fifth cubed. All right, let's write it all out. And what do we get then? Go ahead and rewrite. Remember, this negative sign, I can put it with the 2 or the y or the x. It doesn't really matter, right? And now combine like terms. So 8 and 36, 4 goes into them. So 4 times 9 is 36. 4 times 2 is 8. X to the negative 4 and x to the 6 will give you x squared. Y to the negative 6 and y to the 15 will give you y to the 9. All right, do that on your own. You can always reduce inside here and then simplify, or you can raise everything to 2 power and then simplify. So as long as you make sure that you get the exponent applied correctly, there is many different ways you can solve this problem. So let's just simplify in here because we'll make things easier. 4 goes into h twice, x cubed over x to the negative second. This x to the negative second can go up here and make it x to the fifth. Y to the third and y to the eighth will also give you y to the fifth. Now you're squaring it, so everything gets squared. So x to the fifth squared, y to the fifth squared, 2 squared. And now x to the fifth squared, what do you do with the exponents? You multiply them. So here we go. X to the 10, y to the 10 over 4. All right, alternative solution. If I were to just take everything and square it right away, I would still get the same answer. This is what I was saying, that as long as you're applying the rules correctly, it doesn't matter what order we make it work. So just make sure that from one step to another, you logically can defend it. So 4 squared will be 16, this will be 64, this will be x to the 6, y to the 16, x to the negative 4, and y to the 6. And then, like terms together, simplify 16 over 64, and you get the same answer. No matter what direction you went in, your final answer should be the same, because whichever steps you used, logically, they should reduce to the same fraction. All right, try this next one on your own, please. Pause the video here and see what you can do. So again, you can choose which method you want to use. Let's start with taking all this and reducing it first. So x to the negative third and x to the negative second. This x to the negative second can come up here and give you x to the negative first power. Y to the eighth and y to the third will give you y to the fifth. Once you have that, you can now apply the negative exponent of 2 to all of the quantities that are inside the parentheses. So you'll get negative 4 to the negative second, x to the negative 1 to the negative second, y to the fifth to the negative second, and 3 to the negative second. Remember, you cannot evaluate numbers raised to negative exponents unless you change them to positive exponents first. So this negative 4 to the negative second will have to go in the denominator, become negative 4 squared, which will give you 16. This 3 to the negative second will have to go to the numerator and become 3 squared, which is 9. And then here, you just multiply the exponents. So negative 1 times negative 2 will give you 2. 5 times negative 2 will give you negative 10. Remember, this 9 came because of 3 to the negative second, which moved to the numerator and became 3 squared. This 16 came from negative 4 squared in the denominator, which will give you 16. Can't have negative exponents, so you'll have to rewrite the y to the negative 10th as y to the 10 in the denominator. The second way we showed you, you could have done that way as well. Just take negative second power to each of the quantities inside right away. Again, negative 4 to the negative second will go to the denominator, become negative 4 squared or 16. 3 to the negative second will go to the numerator and make it 9. And then the rest, multiply all the exponents together here. So this will become 6, this will become negative 16, this will become 4, this will become negative 6. Once you have this part, combine like terms. So x to the 6 and x to the 4 will give you what? Good, x to the second power on the numerator. Y to the negative 16 and y to the negative 6 in the denominator will give you y to the negative 10 in the numerator, because you're doing negative 16 minus minus 6. Can't have negative exponents, so again you have to move the y to the negative 10 to the denominator to make it y to the positive 10. Either way, you've gotten the same answer. All right, try this on your own.